You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Welcome to the third story of the month of February, 2024, issue 209. How have you been enjoying the rest of February so far? Well, the good news is you're about to enjoy some more and some more after this. So thank you for stopping by the podcast, for listening, for subscribing, and for chucking a couple of bucks our way over at patreon.com/Clarkesworld. We can't do this without you. We just simply couldn't. Our story is titled The Enceladus South Pole Base Named After V.I. Lenin and is by Zohar Jacobs. Zohar Jacobs grew up in New Hampshire. She has lived for more than 20 years in Oxford, England, and works in cultural policy. A graduate of Bible Paradise, she has stories published or forthcoming in Sunday Morning Transport, Small Wonders, and Analog. Her next goal is to finish reading The Lord of the Rings in Icelandic. How cool is that? Anyway, I hope you can sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. The sketch showed a young woman, her face a perfect oval, holding our base in her cupped hands. Behind her head, Saturn hung golden with its halo of rings. That was the first sign that religion had come with us to Enceladus. I had risen early in the hope of tsatsiki for breakfast, as they were in short supply. Too early, as it turned out, because nothing was ready yet. Lingering by the notice board in the main hall, I had first glanced mechanically toward the shift to schedules, reports on our progress toward the five-year plan, teletype news from TASS and Pravda about the victories of the North Vietnamese, and the medals of Nadia Comaneci. On the other side of the doors was the board's informal counterpart, never officially sanctioned, portraits of Gagarin, Tsiolkovsky, and our own chief designer, a reproduction of the Quinji painting of the coast of Crimea. Alongside them, a hand-drawn cartoon captioned Saturn devouring his children, showing the ringed planet with a gaping, toothy maw. For some time, I had brooded on this cartoon, wondering if it might be a stalking horse for counter-revolutionary sentiments. In the end, I had concluded it was just a joke. Now, this new sketch had appeared. It seemed to be by the same hand. Heart-thumping, I looked around, but the hall was almost empty apart from a couple of workers mopping the floor in the far corner. Then Valery Vladimirovich wandered in through the door, empty coffee cup in hand. Head of the chemistry lab, and our political officer, he was also an early riser. He joined me in front of the wall. "Huh, look at that," he said in disgust. "These fools have reinvented the icon corner. All we need now is a couple of peasants sleeping on top of a stove." I ripped the sketch down and threw it into the recycling. Only after that did it occur to me that it might have been worth saving as evidence, and that it had been rather beautiful. Lenin said it was impossible to build socialism in one country. Within the span of Saturn's rings, we were to prove that it was possible to build it in one solar system. We were more than 200 cosmonauts, the elite of the Soviet Union. Our new colony on Enceladus, far beyond the reach of the imperialist powers, was to demonstrate through its scientific discoveries that communism was mankind's only future. We had launched in 1976, endured a three-year journey to the outer system by nuclear pulse propulsion. It was a miracle that our chief designer had survived his illness in the 60s and had been able to create such a spacecraft. We had been second on the moon. Just. We were first here. To build a world without religion, no one needed to say that this was also our goal. Religion was for subversives and refuseniks, for superstitious village babushkas attempting to indoctrinate loyal Soviet children. You've seen the poster, perhaps? A cosmonaut in his red spacesuit floats in a starry sky high above the spires and domes of the church and mosque. He gazes outward, looking for something invisible. "Burgenjet," says the caption. "There is no God." So said Yuri Gagarin after his historic flight. I looked and looked, but I didn't see God. Neither did we. Not that anyone reported. In our base near the South Pole of Enceladus, where the ice cap was thinnest, we saw nothing above us but stars. Yet all of us had grandmothers, a fact that the program had failed to consider. In the second year after we arrived on Enceladus, one of our number, a Jew according to his passport, decided to be baptized. This came to my attention because it takes a surprising amount of water to immerse a fully grown man. Whether wisely or foolishly, the Christians made an official request rather than surreptitiously filling their improvised font. Underneath our base was a liquid ocean 20 kilometers deep, but in those days we were still short of water. Melting ice is laborious work, as is drilling through a 30-kilometer ice shelf. Even once completed, and we still had some 10 kilometers to go, the borehole was intended only for scientific purposes. As commander of the base, I was responsible for our resources. I denied the request immediately. My weekly meeting with Valeri was later the same day. We met in my room, one of the few truly private places on base, and sat at the tiny table in front of my one porthole. There was nothing to see apart from the jumbled, shadowed, unrelievedly white ice of the surface and Saturn's inner rings bisecting the sky.
"What are we going to do about this, Mikhail Alexandrovich?" said Valeri finally.
"What can we do?" I replied. What means of repression did we have? We were scientists and engineers. For us, the state had truly withered away. We could perhaps have deprived a thief or a saboteur of his liberty if we thought it worthwhile to turn a storage room into a prison cell and one of our scientists into a temporary jailer. If necessary, we could have deprived a murderer of his life. Temperatures hovered at minus 200 degrees Celsius on the surface of Enceladus, but an unsuited man would asphyxiate long before he froze. Almost a kind death compared with a Siberian work camp. These protocols were intended for the event of serious unrest. None of them seemed appropriate to the problem at hand.
"We can denounce him," said Valeri, finally. "That's a start."
No politically unreliable character would have been allowed to go into space. All of us were members of the party. Under the arched vaults of the main hall, we held workplace party meetings to develop our political ideological consciousnesses, commit to improving productivity, pass resolutions of solidarity with the oppressed workers of Earth, and so on. I preferred to allow Valeri to handle most of this. No surprise to either of us when Katya Kavialatskait, our junior doctor, rose spontaneously at the end of the next meeting to denounce the Christians and their selfishness. "As we labor to build socialism here on Enceladus," she said, voice trembling slightly, "we pay tribute to the selfless devotion of the workers to Marxist-Leninist thought. Even at this distance from the imperialists, we must struggle to unmask insidious bourgeois, counter-revolutionary elements. As General Secretary Brezhnev warned at the 25th Party Congress, a high political vigilance and a timely rebuff to hostile ideological sabotage are needed." This stirred a buzz of conversation, which intensified at the end of the meeting as people dispersed. But what good would it do? At home, a scientist known to attend church would never be promoted, would never be permitted to travel abroad. But we were only 207 souls. There was no competition for promotion. It had hardly escaped my attention that our head of medicine, Katya's superior, was one of the most committed sectarians, but we couldn't spare anyone from their duties. All we could do was disprove. It wasn't enough. Religion swept through the crew like measles, a minor social contagion, a childhood disease to which none of us had been exposed, against which we had assumed we were all permanently inoculated. I started to see people crossing themselves before they stepped into the airlock to go out onto the surface. From Katya, whom I suspected had made her career as an informer, I heard that a Hebrew study group was meeting privately in one couple's quarters. Although some of the participants were Russian, according to their documents, it was obvious that they were all actually, excuse the word, Yids. With my own ears, I heard my flight dynamics engineer arguing with his Ukrainian colleague about the nature of the Trinity. A real icon or two appeared briefly on the wall of our assembly, then disappeared just as mysteriously as they had come. Under different circumstances, I might have taken all of this very seriously, but I had more important things to worry about. Our borehole was within weeks of reaching the moon-spanning ocean beneath the ice. The scientific observations we sent back to Earth were already saturating the limited bandwidth of the new 70-meter dishes at Evpatoria, Ossorisk, and Safa. On top of this, Enceladus was entering an active phase. Our orbiting satellites registered deformations in the ice, shifts of tens of centimeters. The scribbling arcs of our seismographs swung with ever-widening amplitudes. Every 33 hours, when Enceladus reached apopsis, and the tidal stresses on its icy crust were at their peak, great geysers of salty water erupted from the south polar fissures. On the horizon, we could see the thunderheads of the plumes themselves, silvery haze against the black sky. Trace hydrocarbons and organic compounds drifted slowly downward to settle on the surface of our detectors. If we were too close to the polar fissures, we risked being caught up in the moon's active cryo-volcanism. We'd made one decision for the base, another for the borehole, where the ice cap had to be thin enough for us to penetrate. We had always known that the borehole posed its own danger. It could weaken the ice, causing a blowout and creating a new cryo-volcano. I was in my bunk when it happened. We felt it even at the base, a subtle, sickening shift in the ice beneath us. I leaped up and went to the porthole. It was just after twilight, so the land was dark, but the massive plume overhead was illuminated by the setting sun. As a young man in the army, stationed briefly in Semipalatinsk, I had seen the mushroom cloud of a nuclear test. The uncanny chill I felt in my stomach then was nothing to what I felt when I saw that plume on Enceladus. A few moments later, the emergency call started to come in. A mist formed around the base and hid the plume from view. The shock of the blast had shifted the ice under our base. A corridor of connecting two modules sprung a sudden leak, and one of our engineers was treated for minor decompression sickness. At the borehole site, five died, buried under the explosive cryo-lava flow. We weren't able to recover their bodies. For nearly 2 days, I didn't sleep. When I finally returned to my bunk, I couldn't stop thinking of the words on that long-forgotten sketch. Saturn devours his children. Or a murmur exchanged earlier in the day that I had not been intended to overhear. It's Lazarus Saturday, you know. Because we feared active unrest, Valery and I allowed a religious funeral to be held for the two Christians who had died at the borehole site. We could not avoid attending. Someone had made kutia, wheat berries with raisins and nutmeg, first taste of the resurrection. Reluctantly, I took a spoonful. I thought I had never eaten it before, but as soon as it touched my tongue, I found myself remembering my great aunt's death, the tiny kitchen where we gathered after the cremation, and the strange taste of consolation. No one asked our permission to celebrate the Easter vigil 4 days later. I came upon the scene neither by accident nor by warning, but through a sort of premonition. It was nighttime on Enceladus as it would have been on Earth. Lights in the corridor were dimmed, turning everything an ashen, gunmetal gray. People spilled out of Arsene's room, which was far too small to contain the crowds. Instead of candles, they carried penlights, which cast constantly shifting shadows across the walls. From inside, there came the sound of chanting and the scent of rose water. Trampling down, death by death, and on those in the tomb bestowing life. I didn't push my way into the room. Instead, I stood at the edge of the throng, watching the ripples of motion pass through the crowd as people crossed themselves, listening to murmured conversations. A few people gave me nervous glances over their shoulders, but said nothing. Across the crowd, I glimpsed Valery, standing slightly apart. His hands were clenched into fists. He caught my eye, then slowly drew a finger across his throat. We met in my room in the morning a few hours later. My eyes were burning with fatigue. I'd barely slept since the accident. The coffee had run out months earlier. Outside, Saturn was gibbous on the horizon. Because Enceladus was tidally locked, the planet neither rose nor set. It just hung over us, its monstrous, bloated sphere a perpetual rebuke to the fickleness of humankind.
"We need to do something," said Valery again.
"What can we do?" I repeated. Time could have been circular. We were sweeping around and around, the same question, unable to reach escape velocity.
"We need to make an example of someone."
No question who that would be.
of Arsenye, I said slowly. Arsenye was one of those scientists who had come to us from the Gulag, where he had been thrown together with thieves, murderers, persecuted priests, old believers, Jehovah's Witnesses, Dukobors, and all manner of sectarians. In a camp near Magadan, he had, so I had heard, been baptized by the imprisoned bishop of Vladimir. So brilliant a physicist was Arsenye that he had been brought back from Siberia in 1949, while Stalin was still alive, to join what Solzhenitsyn called the First Circle. Until Stalin's death, he worked at a sharashka near Ostankino Park in Moscow, one of the special R&D institutes staffed by scientist convicts. You're surprised that a commander in the Russian space program has read Solzhenitsyn. Don't be. There's no harm in being informed. Probably Arsenye had always been an eccentric. Since arriving on Enceladus, he had only become more so. Although a layman rather than a priest or a monk, he had stopped cutting his hair and trimming his beard. The believers on Enceladus were, by necessity, a priestless sect. But they had Arsenye. He's building a cult of personality, said Valery. Already has. It must be stopped. We could have executed Arsenye. Instead, we called him into my room and gave him a choice. Renounce religion, cease his agitation, and confine his search for the truth to the laws of physics and dialectical materialism. Or accept permanent exile from the base. We can't allow you to keep contaminating us with your counter-revolutionary ideas, I told him. He took a ragged breath. For a moment, I believed that he found it a difficult choice. Then he looked at me with his hollow, shadowed eyes and said, I praise God. For years, I have been praying to become a hermit. He's mad, I thought. And then, well, this will be the end of it. I didn't think he would live long in exile. He was not a young man, and his extended imprisonment had left his health uncertain. Solitary confinement had broken stronger men. Back home, they would have sent him to a psychiatric institute. I wondered whether it would have been kinder to execute him. We did nothing to excess. We had modules configurable for independent operation on a science site. We held one barely 2 kilometers from the main base and left it there, thinking of resupply, thinking that one should keep one's enemies close. Out at the borehole, a module slept 6 engineers, shift on shift. But Arsenye's new home would be his alone. Accompany Dacia, grumbled Valery. That's what we're giving him. But I walked Arsenye out to his prison cell, and I can tell you that 2 kilometers is a long way on the ice of Enceladus. Before we had gone 500 meters, the main base was already invisible below the horizon. From the window of the module, he would be able to see nothing but the shadowed, jumbled ice stretching away and Saturn hanging perpetually overhead. For a while after Arsenye's exile, things were quiet. We allowed ourselves to breathe, to believe that this religious episode had been no more than a brief fever, a social contagion of the sort to which small, isolated outposts are often prone. Rebuilding after the blowout, we told ourselves to consider the rest forgotten. Of course, we were wrong. When a society builds up enough internal stresses, enough self-contradiction, repression only increases the likelihood of an eruption. I am no social scientist, but I can tell you that much. Murmurs about religious services began anew. Some of the Jews began refusing to participate in the voluntary Saturday work, subotniks. Some of the Christians responded by refusing to work on Sundays, though this had never been an issue before. People stole out onto the surface without permission, taking spacesuits and walking to Arsenye's module. He had already been father confessor to half the base. All the sentence of banishment had achieved was to transform him into a desert ascetic. What could we do? Dismantle half the base and turn it into a makeshift penal colony? I persuaded Valery that we should turn a blind eye to private practices, so long as there was no evangelization. Maybe such a thing would have worked in America, the separation of church and state. Not for Russians. Work stoppages started soon after that. Imagine it,
Soviet cosmonauts going on strike, demanding a pardon for Arsenia. Demanding that they be allowed to hold divine liturgy in the main hall. Demanding freedom, as odd as that might sound. Who would have said they lacked freedom? Here, on the icy plains of Enceladus, billions of kilometers from everything we had known, a man could leap so high that he could see the curve of the moon. Here, we were building a new world. Maybe it was the distance that made them clutch at the relics of Earth. Strikers roamed the corridors of the station. No need for barricades when you have airlocks. No way to use guns with the ever-present threat of fire in the oxygen-rich air. I was seriously considering selective explosive decompression when we heard the news from the new borehole site. We had discovered life on Enceladus. Against a background of hammering and shouting outside, my few allies and I bent over the console in my room and watched the first images materialize line by line on the television screen. Now those images have become familiar, but I will never forget the feeling of that first brush of the alien, shapes indistinct in the monochrome fuzz of the transmission, yet with outlines unmistakably organic, fronds and tentacles and branching arms clustered around a volcanic vent and reaching out into the currents of the moon-spanning sea. Small, blind, simple creatures to whom our submersible was as incomprehensible as the universe beyond. If the blowout had not forced us to move our borehole site, we might never have found them. Tears gathered in my eyes, gravity too low to allow them to fail. Very few times in a man's life, he suddenly understands that the universe is much wider than he ever could believe. Such was this moment for me. I had expected microorganisms, algae perhaps. Nothing like this. Imagine cutting into a pearl and finding not grit but another world, whole and entire. Just as another image began to scan across the screen, the power went out, leaving a phosphor ghost in a room lit only by Saturn's reflected light. The strikers were closing in. I reached for the mechanical interlock switches that would bend the corridor's atmosphere into space. During the last sleepless night, I had gotten out of bed just to feel the cold metal shapes of those switches beneath my hands, asking myself whether I had the courage to go through with it. Now I knew I couldn't. A détente, I said, letting my hand fall. In another existence, I might have used depressurization against the striking workers. In this existence, I chose differently. Enceladus had transformed us all. We banged out a message of surrender on the door in Morse code. With three of us pushing from my side and the strikers from the other, we forced it open. In that darkened corridor, with flashlights playing across pale, expectant faces that had once been familiar to me, I was reminded of Easter. As I announced the discovery of life in the tomb, signs of the cross echoed across the gathered crowd. Humiliation, perhaps. Neither weakness nor strength looked the same on Enceladus as they did in Moscow. My surrender saved both my own life and that of the other 206 souls on the moon. The future was a treasure worth preserving. Not so long after the victory of the strikers, they held divine services in the main hall of the station. It was the third year of Arsenia's exile from the base. "I've grown accustomed to solitude," he had told me, a modest demural, when I commuted his sentence. He could do his work just as easily from his cell. So he had decided, I thought, to remain in exile. He had returned only to lead a service of thanksgiving and remembrance, insofar that it was possible without a priest. Some of his more ardent followers were now claiming that he had been secretly ordained in the Siberian camps, but Arsenia himself did not go that far. Wearing the vestments of a deacon, painstakingly embroidered for him by one of the kitchen staff, he stood under the dome before the assembled company chanting the Psalms. "I am counted with them that go down into the pit." I would have liked to punch him in the face. I envied him too. Easy to be a leader of men tucked away from life and all responsibility, busy praising your imagined God. Was I not the man described in the psalm rather than him? Having been exalted, I was humbled and brought to distress.
Thy furies have passed upon me, and thy terrors have sorely troubled me. They come round about me like water. All the day long they compassed me about together. Several of the worshippers had come from the borehole site. They wore full protective gear in case they carried some biological contamination from the Enceladus Sea. It seemed ironic we had carried the infection with us all the time. On the ceiling of the dome, the Christians had painted an image of Christ, Pantocrator. Waste of time, didn't we have enough beauty above us? Under his pitiless gaze, I stood once again at the edge of the crowd, watching others prostrate themselves on the dented metal deck. I couldn't stay away, but I couldn't take part. I didn't want to take part. My mouth moved silently, almost against my will. Lord, have mercy. No one needed to tell me that my days as commander of the mission were numbered. No man could count on eternal forgiveness from any other than the Almighty, if he existed at all, a fact of which I was still not persuaded. I was certainly not persuaded at the forgiveness of these new Christians. Surrendering what you believe for the greater good wins you neither friends nor admirers. Not even from the other unbelievers. The other dissidents, as I would have to think of them now. I was alone. In the middle of that great throng of worshippers, thinking of those who had died, and all of us living in the midst of death, I dropped my head and began to weep. Completing its breaking orbits, the new ship from Earth was a green dot scribing overlapping arcs across our trajectory display. I stared at that dot until the afterimages floated in my vision. Our 10-year mission had been planned without relief or resupply. Secretly, I had always expected a one-way trip. I had access to sensitive news bulletins. I knew about the Soviet Union's faltering economy. Surely there was nothing left to invest in our tiny, tenuous colony. I was wrong. News of life on Enceladus changed everything. Within weeks, we'd heard that a new mission had suddenly moved from blueprints to reality, a crash program with improved propulsion technologies. Less than a year later, we were to be joined by nearly 1,000 cosmonauts, among whom numbered throngs of biologists eager to delve into the mysteries beneath our feet. A dramatically expanded base, new plans, a new start. My problems would soon belong to a new commander. I wondered if he knew what he was getting into. Over the years, we had told Earth less and less, and about certain things, religion among them, nothing at all. Earth told us less too, those final few years. We didn't question. Perhaps we should have. In the days before the relief mission arrived, there were hushed arguments about informers. Some believers planned to go underground. Others were determined to keep building their new Jerusalem. The dozen or so Jews, still fearing a return to the persecutions under the Tsars, were holding their breath. One man was jumped and beaten in an airlock for no reason that anyone would admit. That was where all of this brotherly love led us. We had known freedom, whatever that meant. We would now face the consequences. We probably deserved them. We gathered in front of the main airlock to welcome the new arrivals to Enceladus. To set the right mood, I had unearthed an old banner salvaged from unused parachute fabric, which read "Glory to Soviet Science." In my head, I was rehearsing the private conversation that I had intended to have with Major General Mitrokhin. Hopefully, before he noticed the Christ Pantocrator that gazed down so disdainfully from the main dome. You couldn't lead a base in the outer solar system as if you were the commander of a submarine or a silo launch complex in Latvia, I would tell him. It was infinitely more complex, its societal trajectory vulnerable to every chaotic perturbation and yet paradoxically resistant to guidance. Any imposition to force at this juncture might. Special pleading, of course. How else could a man plead? What chapter of Marxist-Leninist thought could have prepared us for this? As the airlock door ground open, my stomach churned in sympathy. A memory from a different world came to me. Velvet curtains sweeping across at the Bolshoi, dancers poised in their places. Except that it was cosmonauts on the other side of the airlock, moving clumsily in the unfamiliar low gravity. They were led by their commander, whom I recognized from the photographs. Comrade Mitrokin, I said formally. He blinked at me, then returned my salute. Only then did I notice the patch on his shoulder. Not the red Soviet flag, but the old Imperial Russian tricolor.
The Soviet Union is no more, said Major General Mitrokin, bowing his head a little as if an apology. I'm sorry to be the one to bring you this news.
He spoke about reconstruction, about reform and transparency, about new opportunities. A little, even about science, glancing with a curious look at the banner on the wall. I could absorb nothing. My mind reeled. The revolution had not only devoured its children, it had devoured itself.
Of course, I said stiffly, an automaton. What concerns us most of all is the success of the mission.
Valery leaned to my side.
We could hardly expect them not to have had a revolution, he said dryly, when we've had one of our own.
Ah, yes, Valery. Well, he might say that, not long after the conclusion of the strike he had been baptized. Perhaps no surprise. He'd made a career out of knowing which way the wind was blowing. The news of the relief mission had thrown him into a panic. Now he suddenly found himself on the right side of history again. And I'm beginning to feel that I've never been on the right side of history. A hollow man, I ate my dinner that night under the central dome, with Christ Pantocrator looking down at me disapprovingly.
Never mind me, he seemed to say. Do you believe in anything at all?
A fair question. What was belief and what unbelief? I wasn't certain I could tell the difference anymore. The news from home sounded like the utterest science fiction. Plans for a joint American-Soviet mission to Europa. McDonald's on Red Square. Churches reopening as if they'd never been closed. Communal farms sold off to aspiring capitalists. The Ukraine, where I was born, becoming an independent country. The Soviet Union melting away, apparently unlamented, after 70 years of existence. I had devoted my life to the Soviet state, first in the army and then as a cosmonaut. I had left my wife and children behind to come to the outer system to build what? What had I built in the end? The fragile life under the ice of Enceladus had existed longer than humanity and would probably exist long after we had destroyed ourselves. Across the long dining table sat Leonid Moisevich, one of our mechanical engineers. Watching him stolidly drinking chicken soup from a foil pouch, I felt incapable of sharing my troubling thoughts. I was grateful for his company. Almost no one cared to sit with me now, and no more capable of expressing my gratitude. Being base commander had not trained me to share my feelings.
Have you heard, I said, that the Ukraine has declared independence?
Banderites, he said with disgust. They're all banderites.
He threw down the foil pouch. Sucked dry, it bounced slowly off the table, only minimally restrained by the moon's ghost of gravity. Even after years on Enceladus, I found this an eerie sight. I continued.
Are we expected to simply accept all of this?
Leonid shrugged.
What choice do we have? What choice have we ever had?
To go on building socialism, I said.
If you figure out how to do that, he replied, taking a bite from a piroshek, let me know.
I took my first leave of absence in years to visit the new borehole site and see how things stood there. Rather than taking a rover, I went on foot. I needed the time to think. Not such a long walk, only 20 kilometers. A man could have walked around the whole moon in less than 2 weeks. I went out, alone, onto the white, seamed ice. After a handful of minutes, the base disappeared below the horizon. The sun was low and distant and dim, despite the glare off the ice. Like Siberia in late autumn. I felt a chill through my heated gloves. Saturn gazed down on me, as disapproving as Christ Pantocrator, and far more real. The swirls and eddies on its surface were all chaos and complexity, far more visible through a clean faceplate than the grimed windows of the brightly lit station. Even a supercomputer couldn't tell you what the pattern might be a year from now. Even with my eyes open, I saw phosphorescent flashes in my vision, charged particles, bare nuclei whipping through Saturn's orbit. Relics of the blast wave of some supernova thousands of years ago. Not even the most energetic particles penetrated the kilometer of ice under my feet.
The dwellers in the pitch-black sea beneath were hidden away from the universe beyond. I saw an illuminated window before I realized where my steps had led me. It was Arsenius' cabin. The main base was hardly 2 kilometers away, but we might have been alone in the middle of the tundra. I knocked at the airlock. Although it was late, Arsenia was still awake. "Well," he said, once I had stepped through the airlock and taken off my helmet. He sounded as if he expected me. He ushered me into his module, a single room with a hammock hanging in the corner and a small galley. While he made tea, I looked at the walls, which were covered with data printouts, their margins full of scrawled equations. In his spare time, I had been told, he was working on a mathematical proof of the existence of God, following the work of Paul Florensky. Interspersed between the equations were icons drawn on the same printed paper. Those serene oval faces were as blankly impenetrable to me as Arsenius' physics. "Have you come with news?" he asked finally, sipping his tea. I took a breath. "I've come to ask for your advice." "Before you judge me, ask yourself if you can find a single human being on Earth or beyond who has never been a hypocrite. None exist. We all struggle to live as best we can. In whom could I confide, if not Arsenia? As commander of the base, there had been no one I could turn to. Now I had been replaced by Major General Mitrokhin. It was impossible to confess my loyalty to ideals that he and my country had apparently left behind. Beside, I wanted to ask Arsenia's forgiveness." Stumbling, I told him all this. By the time I'd finished, my tea had gone cold. He said nothing, only listened with steepled hands. "Perhaps it's a mistake to believe in anything at all," I concluded. "It's certainly easier not to," said Arsenia, with a trace of bitterness. "Didn't we all come here because we believed in something? I did what I was sent here to do, for the good of the mission and the good of all of us here on Enceladus." I refrained from pointing out that his fellow Christians on the base had brought not peace but a sword. Apart from churches, what had his religion built? Had it raised dams and power stations and factories, electrified the Soviet Union, laid railway tracks, constructed the heavy lift rockets that brought us here? No, we did that ourselves, human beings, because we believed in creating a better world. We created the Gulag, too. Of course, I admitted, I'm not blind. I myself was not involved with any of that. Perhaps some of it was necessary. I can hardly judge. But I had hoped that we could leave all that behind when we came to Enceladus. We couldn't. We brought ourselves along. "Of course I forgive you," said Arsenia, most impatiently. "How could I do otherwise? Who among us hasn't sinned?" Too easy. I had been expecting to argue with him, to be forced to justify myself. All of my arguments had been wasted on the silent ice of Enceladus. Some trace of my dissatisfaction must have been evident to Arsenia. "Is that not good enough?" he added. "Were you wanting me to tell you that only God can forgive?" I didn't, but it was certainly what I had been expecting. I had assumed that you would tell me the same thing you told Valeri, that I should repent and become a Kachuman. "Valeri came asking to be baptized. You haven't." "I'm not a believer." "Let Christ pantocrator on the central dome. Try though I might, I couldn't view it any differently than a poster of Stalin, a man in whose name people strove to do good, around whom a monstrous cult of personality had been built, in whose name millions had been killed, behind whom Russia had gathered once and might gather again. And I am not a priest or a monk," said Arsenia. "Even molecules are too big for me to comprehend, to say nothing of human beings. I decided to stay out here because I didn't want to tell anyone else how to live, only to pray for the world and strive for my own salvation." "If you haven't found salvation yet, what am I meant to do?" He smiled at the same enigmatic, infuriating smile that haunted the lips of the saints. "What do you think I do? Pray without ceasing, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. That's all." Those last two words neatly forestalled my next question. "We know where the church is," he added, "but we don't know where it isn't." Through the window, I saw night falling across the ice. With no atmosphere, the darkening was sudden. but the icy fragments of Saturn's E-ring were still illuminated above. A broad, aureole-like, high, thin cloud. For a moment, I imagined what Arsenia saw. A whole universe filled to the brim with grace, trembling, spilling over. Who was to say that what he believed was any more unlikely than all that we'd discovered in this wide, wild place? Then the shadow of Enceladus passed across the ring, and there was darkness. I shook my head and told Arsenia that if I didn't get to the borehole site soon, they would send out a search party. As I suited up, he said little, but before I left, he gave me the book of the Psalms, no bigger than the palm of a hand. It must have been printed before the revolution. I wondered who it had belonged to across all those years. What impetus had carried it all the way to Enceladus? "You might also try going out into the wilderness," he told me. I looked in surprise at the little book as if it could offer any answers. "The wilderness?" He spread his arms wide all around us, just like desert fathers. What could be easier? I wonder now if Arsenia already knew. I heard the news from Major General Mitrokin. In the office that used to be mine, it had been decided, he didn't say by whom, that we would build a small exploratory base on Titan. Maybe the Americans were heading for Titan too. It was possible they would push for this to become a joint mission. "But whatever they do," he added, "there's no harm in us being there first." For the first time in my career, I didn't pause to consider my next move. "Sir, I would like to command the new base." The furrow in Mitrokin's brow, apparent on his arrival, had already deepened. I held my breath. He might have said anything, that I had been denied a security clearance, that he wanted to keep me where he could keep his eye on me, that my arrest was imminent. "That will be convenient on multiple fronts," he replied slowly, "as is this whole idea." Our new commander was rather savvy. As we both had realized, a new base could serve as a pressure valve, a new home for all those who were dissatisfied with the current regime and for unpopular reminders of their previous regime, namely myself. Where would Russia have been without Siberia? Where indeed? After the announcement, there were murmurings across the base about who might be sent away and why. A square-jawed military man from the new expedition praised Mitrokin for sweeping out the old rubbish. Believers with beaten metal crosses around their necks rejoiced at the triumph of orthodoxy. People started derisively calling the new base Birobidzhan, after the Jewish national homeland in Siberia. Scientists who might have once sacrificed anything to spend one day on Titan now hurriedly disclaimed any interest in going. Not that I heard all this with my own ears, you understand. I still have a few sources. None of it bothered me because I retained a sense of adventure. Titan, with its frigid hydrocarbon seas, its methane clouds, its dim, hazed surface. To set foot on one new world and command one new colony would have been the pinnacle of any cosmonaut's career. To do it for a second time could only be a privilege. Exile is in the eye of the beholder. "You won't be able to choose your crew," said Valery, having taken me aside in a maintenance alcove to avoid the social awkwardness of being seen with the station's former commander. His own role in the repressions had apparently been forgotten with his conversion. "I wasn't able to choose them the first time." "True," he paused. "They'll be a ragtag bunch, though. Do you really see a future for yourself out there?" "Why? What future are you looking at?" "Things are moving faster at home than they are here," said Valery. "I've made the acquaintance of some men who are setting up commercial enterprises to invest in state assets as they're sold off. Agricultural equipment, factories, and the like. Opportunities for those of us with the initiative to grasp them. I don't plan to be out here forever." Agricultural equipment factories, indeed. I thought I knew what he meant. Plowshares into swords. On Enceladus, where not a shot had been fired in anger, the idea seemed obscene. I briefly considered this an attempt at entrapment before realizing that Valery, in his way, was trying to do me a good turn. These were the new horizons opened up by the collapse of the Soviet Union. We had once believed in something more. I didn't think much of Valery's newfound faith. My reply was a simple, "I do."
We left as soon as we were able. After launch, the moon fell away from our ship with an almost absurd ease, as if in mockery of those labored ascents from the steppes of Kazakhstan. Dwindling by the second, Enceladus hung like a pearl in the blackness of space, wreathed in the faint aureole of Saturn's E-ring. At the South Pole, so distant as to be almost invisible, I could make out the tiny plumes of eruptions, such a small thing to contain so much within. What have we salvaged from our rushed departure? Valeri was right to call us a ragtag bunch. Most of the station's Jews, some of our best scientists and engineers, along with one Crimean Tatar. A number of atheists, among whom I suppose I can still count myself, and a handful of Christians still passionate about science, socialism, or both. Among these, Katya, abashed, apparently a true believer after all. And finally, two members of the crew, either gone native remarkably quickly or sent to keep an eye on me. I don't know. It hardly seems to matter. Let others build their new Jerusalem, their fourth Rome, their second Moscow. We will go on building socialism on one moon, wherever that moon may be. I know that we'll discover something beyond imagining out there. I have no idea what it might be. I can only hope that we'll understand it when we see it. But we understand so little. Not even ourselves. What are your thoughts on the story? You can send me an email at kate@clarksworldmagazine.com, and that is Clark with an E. I hope that you have enjoyed this story and the ones that come before it and the ones that shall come after. And with that, I do bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.